super happy to be here today. And Claudio, Massimo, we're going to have a conversation around the energy transition. And it's really different compared to what it used to be a decade ago. Now, all of a sudden, we're part of the cool industry and we have a lot of new employees that have come on board just recently. It's great to see this. And this energy transition also needs to be just. And it's much more complexity out there now compared to what it used to be. And that will need flexibility and we need digitalization. There are so many things that we need, but how are we going to meet up to all these new demands? Claudio, you were in the US, Massimo, you were in Spain, and you all saw different perspectives. Claudio, do you want to start? Give us a bit of perspective on this.
Sure, thanks, Therese. It's, you're basically addressing the key point that in order for us to deliver this new energy system, which of course, the more electrified, the more efficient will be, but it needs a lot of technology. It needs a lot of managing these additional complexities. Also needs a lot of collaboration because it's cross sectors. We need to electrify buildings, we need to electrify transport, we need to electrify industry. And on top of that, we need to strengthen and grow the existing electricity system. So the grids and with the renewables and then more consumption on the other side, and flexibility comes just right there. And you know, it's great that Massimo had the opportunities to introduce that work that the team has been doing on how important is flexibility, but also how much technology is already there available to tackle that.
Yeah, and I think it's pretty clear. I mean, I was in Bilbao at Wind Europe, and everybody was talking about, of course, the big investments in wind and in the fact that you know, Europe needs to decarbonize and to have all this renewable energy. But one of the things where people were really in violent agreement was that you cannot just do that. You need to really reshape the whole grid and the way the grid works. And so there is where the flexibility thing comes in, with the need of having a more active grid, so more power electronics in the grid. They need to introduce HVDC to transfer big bulk of energy from one place to another. The need to manage actively the loads and the demand side. So there are a number of different components that, if you think about the way the grid was structured 20 years ago, with big power plants and the industrial centers quite localized in certain places. Now it will be completely different, more distributed. Will require a lot more control, you know, the complexity explodes from that point of view. And here's where digital kicks in to help doing the planning better for this very complex system, to manage the real-time aspect of the grid, which was more trivial, if you think, in the past. And eventually also to interact with the markets, because the energy markets are becoming as very, very complex.
And certainly one point that you've been making all the time, Massimo, is the fact that because of this renewable and because of this distributed resources and the variability that these resources bring, it's not enough anymore to say next hour I see so much demand and therefore I need to match the supply. You need to do this on a 5-minute basis. And that's, of course, it's a huge amount of data that you need to manage. But with the team on the Hitachi Digital side, I think we have a lot of capabilities to tackle that in a much broader perspective.
You're absolutely right, Claudio. There are a couple of aspects. One, of course, is you need to have different gear out there, like battery storage, for instance, to cope with this variability, but also you need to have the capability to forecast and understand better what's going to happen in the future. You know, that was not really a problem in the past, but now forecasting load, forecasting the power production and the variability of weather, whether it's wind or sun, becomes more important. Bringing this into algorithms that allow to optimize the way you run the various parts of the grid and the generation, of course, as well as the demand in certain cases. But then you have the market piece. And if you think there are markets like Australia, where they have to optimize energy products like capacity or like grid support every 5 minutes. And there are several of these products which are co-optimized. And this is, where the whole flow of money also is, not only the electrons. So very, very complicated. And in that respect, digital is a big help. And thinking also about the use of artificial intelligence and machine learning to try to solve some of this complexity or reduce some of this complexity. You mentioned it, working with digital people like Hitachi Digital that have been working on similar topics in other sectors, other industries, is definitely quite a big advantage and help.
And then while Massimo was at Wind Europe, explaining why flexibility is important, but how can we have the technology to deal with it. I was in Houston in the U.S. At CERAWeek, which is a broader energy forum, where one important point that we were making with all the stakeholders there is that yes, the system will be more complex because, as we said, it needs to be more integrated and all of that. Good news is that technology is there to deal with that, but also very important to understand for every stakeholder that the energy system under the electrification, it's way more efficient. And the example that I always bring up, which is easier to understand, is how much of the energy that you produce in a fossil energy system with oil and so on, and how much of that energy then you get at the wheel of your car. And if all of that is fossil, including the car with combustion engines, you barely get one third. So you have to put 3 units of source of energy and get only one to spin your wheel. On the electricity side, if you start doing this with renewables and it's all electrons that flow and go into an electric motor in your car, then it's basically 80 to 85% of that energy that you get at the wheel. And that of course means that you don't need to worry about replacing every single unit of energy anymore. And that's of course something that we have to keep on reminding everybody that yes, there is complexity, but there is also huge gain in terms of efficiencies.
And that's really interesting that there is not just one solution or one technology that will be the key for this next step. It'll be a mix, it sounds like, and it sounds like it's going to require multiple generations to help each other, younger generations, older generations, because with all the digitalization you're talking about, I'm guessing that we need to also bring on new talents from the younger generation into the energy sector. Would that be correct?
Yeah, there Massimo is probably the one that is right at the center of that, looking for as many as talents that we need on the digital side.
Look, that was also a point which was made with various people in Bilbao. I'm deeply convinced. The thing is, as you mentioned, it's not just one technology or one thing that you need to master. So we probably don't have enough of people that have a background in power systems, but understand, native digital, or that understands computing. So you need to put together a number of things now, where probably the generation of people that have the not only the talent but the skill, the background is to be formed. So I believe that this going forward should be a focus for all of us, companies, enterprises, but also universities, to form the people. And it's a little bit of a multidisciplinary kind of, broader spectrum that we need to create. Specialists are always needed, but computing engineers will always be needed, etc. But how do you put this whole thing together, because you need to understand the subject matter expertise on one end, understand what the technology for computing, digital, etc. So it's a complicated thing, and I think it will require forming new type of talents.
And if you think about the opportunity then for people that is thinking now, where should I go next after I've done my education and so on and so forth, It's an incredible place, as you mentioned it at the beginning. You know, it's cooler certainly than it was before, and because it is a way more integrated sector that we're looking at, and people that comes in to support the energy transition will have to the opportunity to understand what can we do on the mobility side, what can we do on the buildings, what can we do on industry, and on the energy system as such. With technologies that span from power electronics, as Massimo was mentioning, digitalization across, and we need all of it. And then, of course, in our case, we're also focusing a lot from a technology standpoint to make sure that the hardware, the products, the systems, and the services that we provide to our customers are also sustainable. So a lot of technology goes into innovating to take out carbon footprint from that asset. So it's exciting place, and as you also mentioned, we need to make sure that that energy transition is a just energy transition. And one way to do this is to support everyone out there to go through that learning, to go through that education path, and make sure that we make that opportunity available to everyone.
And I believe there is also a piece of understanding there are also difficult things and threats in this whole thing, because if you think about you know, this widespread digitalization across the grid, we should also be mindful about risks like cybersecurity. When you use you know, artificial intelligence, you might start thinking about intellectual property protection. So you can start thinking about hallucination and other things that of course are real risks also in other sectors, but in this sector would become dramatic if not properly managed. So I think that is also part of the culture and as well as you know, skill sets that need to be created, because frankly, you know, that was not what you were training engineers 20 years back, but now it's real.
And then Massimo was making a very important point that we are, of course, in critical infrastructure. Without electricity, there cannot be economic growth, there cannot be development. So you need to provide that. It's like, you know, one side is water, the other one is next, right after clean water, you have to ensure that you have power and you have electricity. So, but it is a fantastic moment. It's a moment that is happening across globally. Every single market, every single country, every single government, and every other stakeholder involved, they have an opportunity to contribute, and we need everybody to, you know, as much as we can attract talents to come in and help us on scaling.
Yeah, when you mentioned that in terms of the importance, the mission critical infrastructure we're working with, I experienced 9 hours of power outage last week, and this is not fun because all of a sudden it's cold and you cannot get that phone charged either, and your computer is running out of battery. But not only that, you cannot flush the toilet, you cannot open the fridge, you cannot open the freezer because you don't know when the power is coming back. So that's just tiny problems in the bigger picture. But
now just think about how many billions are do not have access to all
Absolutely.
That electricity. It's only 9 hours, and people live their entire lives without access to. So just think about the huge difference that would make.
Absolutely, and depending on where you're at in the total world, it's obviously a very different experience. Now, you mentioned collaboration between different stakeholders, Claudio, and it sounds like we're dealing with such a complexity that collaboration is essential. And it's not that many years until we reach 2030. How are we going to deal with all this?
It's again, mission critical infrastructure. Lead times are long in our space. Some of the projects that we're dealing with, they have delivery times already now. We're starting now, but they have delivery times 2030 or even beyond that. So it's about the scaling. It's about finding models, not just the technology itself, but finding models through also technology like digital. Definitely will help in finding models that help us together with our customers, with our partners. To accelerate the planning, the design, accelerating also the permitting that is needed to build all this infrastructure, because you need to build lines, you need to build stations, mm-hmm. and so on. And all of that comes with, of course, the opportunity more than the risk of leveraging technology that will help us in doing this in a much more efficient way and a much more digitalized way, and then accelerate that that pace.
I think there is also a component of partnerships. I think that there is not, I don't think there is a company that can do it all alone, on its own. And I think that the future will be more, particularly in digital, but also in other spaces, more of you know, collaboration also across companies and alliances and partnerships in digital, thinking about you know, working with hyperscalers, for instance. So I don't think you can you can avoid doing that if you have to do things fast and at scale like we have to do in the next few years. So I think that component is a very important one.
And it's collaboration also across the stakeholders, including government, including policymakers. It is important that they understand, we know, what technology providers like us can do from a technology standpoint. Not only the technology that is available today, but also what we're working and the technology that we'll be able to deliver in the next couple of years, because that will then allow us to adapt their policies and integrate and allow those technologies then to scale as soon as they're available and not wait another decade before that happens.
It sounds like we're really in a cool place, and together with everyone else who's in this energy sector, we have a lot of work to do.
Indeed, for sure. We do, and I think that we're blessed in to be in this space, and I look forward to more of this conversation. Look forward to attract more talents to engage in this type of discussion. From our side, technology is, of course, it's one of our foundations, as we have it in our 2030 plan, but together with that is people. We need the people element, we need the talent, and we will generate, with diverse teams, we generate a lot of innovation.
Yeah, I believe that the component of diversity is also important. You know, bring resources into this. You know, we are all here to, you know, in this exciting time, we are saving the planet all together. So it's also a very, very exciting and compelling proposition. But we need fresh ideas coming from all angles. So diversity is also becoming a very, very important topic.
Excellent. Thank you so much. It's been really interesting and fun to have a conversation. I look forward to future conversations as well. And thank you again for joining me here today.
Thank you, Therese.
Thank you.
Thank you, Massimo.
Thank you. Thanks, Claudio.
Thank you.